What's up, YouTube? Today we're learning the secret sauce of making money as a producer. Before we get to the video, please leave a like, please subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, because apparently only 60% of y'all watching is actually subscribed to this channel. So just subscribe right now, bro, it's totally free. If you want to, you can unsubscribe later, but right now, just subscribe. If you have any questions like this, make sure to stick around to the end of the video because I might have already answered your question. So today I'm not really going to open my FL Studio because we're talking about making money as a producer. I've come up with 11 ways for you to make money as a producer. So after this video, you can't tell me, bro, I can't make money as a producer. You gotta start doing all of these 11 things and you'll definitely, like, within a year or a year and a half, you'll be able to make a decent amount of money from making beats. If you, next to this, obviously improve in making beats, which is the main thing you have to do to make money as a producer, you know. So next to all of these things that I will describe right now, be sure to practice making beats every single day. First thing is the most obvious thing. It's placements. For placements, they will get you money, you know. Placements will give you a flat fee and will give you royalties and publishing royalties. So that's three things, three income streams that you will be able to generate off of placements. Depending on the name or the value or how big you are as a producer, the flat fee will be higher or lower. Depending on how big the track is, you will get more or less streaming revenue. Also, it also depends on what kind of deal you have with the artist. But generally speaking, placements is a good way of earning money off of your beats. But you have to get to the point where you know artists and you are in contact with artists who will get you money for your placements, you know. Because if you get a placement with your local artist from your town, he won't really pay you a lot. So in that case, it's better to work with, like, a, I don't know, a 50-50 arrangement or something like that. But hey, placements is number one, is the number one income stream, I think, for a lot of the mainstream producers. If you're not that, don't focus too much on it too in the beginning. Like, places will come when they come. I've been producing for like 5 or 6 or 7 years, and only these last 2 years I've been really starting to get the placements that I want to get. So just don't stress too much about placements, but it is a good way of making money, so I had to mention it. Number two is leasing. You know, you obviously know that, but putting beats over on beat licensing sites like BeatStars or other sites like that is a really, really good way for you to start earning an income off of your music without already having the network of a lot of big artists. So leasing is kind of like the way for producers to just be independent and not have to rely on a whole bunch of places and whatnot. Just put your beats out there on a beat licensing platform and be sure to drive traffic to that platform, because nowadays a lot of people are making beats, and some people would say, oh, it's almost impossible to, because the beat market is so oversaturated and whatnot. That's excuses. It is really saturated, but it's not oversaturated. And I mean, just be consistent, put out good beats, and people will start leasing them. So there's no reason not to put out your beats for leasing. Don't be afraid, like, I'm not gonna have any control over my beat. Just sell your licenses. Look into the licenses that BeatStars offers, for example, and just make sure that you protect yourself. But don't be too paranoid that people are gonna steal your music or whatever. Just, you know, just roll with it and you'll learn along the way. Number three is selling drum kits, making kits, making sounds. You can go out and record sounds with a test cam. You can make 808s or you can make snares and claps and hats and whatever inside of your software. It doesn't matter, just make fire sounds. I don't see a lot of producers actually focusing on making sounds, but you could be the producer that now stops focusing on making beats and just produces kits and now becomes the producer that defines the sound for all of these beats. So it really depends on how you look at it and what you want to do, but making kits is definitely a really good income stream for you as a producer. Number four is making loops, and even making loops is a good way to get you placements as well, but making loops in itself is already a really good thing because you can sell loop kits. And also, if you place a loop with a bigger producer or something like that, it will automatically also generate streaming royalties, publishing royalties and all of that stuff. So, you know, making loops is by far the best way for an upcoming producer to get placements with other producers or artists. Like, the amount of loops that people send me every day. So many loops that you guys send to me in current productions that I gave placements to. Just guys like you watching this video just because they sent me loops. So making loops, definitely if you get good, but it's like, make good loops, because you can't make these trash loops and expect somebody to use them. Get good at making loops, send loops to producers, and producers will use them. Because if a producer like me is in a session, and it's the kind of session where it's fast, you have to just be able to pull up a whole bunch of loops and just be fast. So in the session like that, I like to pull up loops and I like to just go from vibe to vibe to vibe. So hey, if you're lucky, you get a placement with me, bro. Hey, number five, ad revenue. So ad revenue is talking about things like YouTube and SoundCloud and all of that stuff. If you put up your beats or your music on certain platforms, it will generate ad revenue from people watching or listening. So that will be maybe a smaller portion of your income, but you can't ignore it, because the ad revenue is something you just chill, you're not doing anything, and it just comes in. So it's a really good source of passive income, you know, just put it out there. And then after that, it's just out there, and maybe in 1 year one of your videos goes viral and you get a whole bunch of money for it. It, you know, ad revenue is a really good source of money. Okay, the next thing is brand deals, and this is something that's more for producers who build out a kind of brand around themselves. It's not for everybody. Some producers just like to be low-key in the background and just making beats for artists like that. Other producers like me like to build a brand around themselves. I don't know who else does it. Nick Mira, TM88, Southside, all of the all of the producers that you know have built out, Metro Boomin, all that stuff. They've built out a brand around themselves, which will also attract other brands that want to work with you. Obviously with brand deals, you always have to like make sure you just don't always just go for the bag, because you have to protect the integrity of your brand. I won't sell you guys toothpaste or something like that, something that I think is trash. I won't actually put that in a video for you guys to see, because I only want to show you guys stuff that is actually really cool and brands that I really like to work with. My speakers, Adam Audio, for example, these are companies that I would have worked with anyways if they hadn't reached out to me. So it's like a win-win situation, these brand deals. Definitely a really, 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 really good thing. Next thing is affiliate marketing. Is done by affiliate links, and affiliate links are links that you put in your social media or whatever platform that you use. So if people are actually following you for what you do and try to be inspired by you and whatnot, just make sure you put in affiliate links for the stuff that you're using. For example, I have a video and you want to buy this couch, and in the description down below I have a link to that couch, but it's my unique link, and if you buy that couch through seeing my video, I will get a certain percentage of your purchase. Most of the time with affiliates, it will be like about a 15% commission or something like that, that I would get for you buying that couch because you saw it in my video. So affiliate marketing is definitely something that's very good. It's also like passive income, you know, you just put the links there, and maybe over time it will just generate you a good amount of money, you know. It's about adding all of these things together. Next thing is streaming. Don't forget, if you're making beats, you're also a musician, and there's people that like to listen to instrumental music. Even me, I have 3 beat tapes that are already quite old over on Spotify, each with over 1 million streams on those beat tapes, which also just generates some streaming revenue, you know. And if you upload beats, you keep 100% of these royalties. Normally if you work with an artist, you get a small amount of royalties. So if you put beats on Spotify and streaming platforms, you get 100% of those royalties. So maybe putting a beat tape on Spotify will generate you more money than getting a placement with a mediocre artist, you know. So it's really important that you do all of these things. Next up is doing sessions. So me, even I've gotten really good at recording people and engineering. So I'm not like, oh no, I just make beats, I don't engineer. No, you can also do engineering. So then you can start charging artists for doing sessions, like with an hourly rate or something like that. Me personally, I don't charge for the sessions I do, because I just work with the people that I absolutely want to work with, but there's other producers that I know that make an insane amount of money by just doing sessions every day. So if you get good at engineering, it's actually one of the easiest ways to make a good amount of money off of producing, because you're just in the studio, you get an hourly rate, the artist is happy that he can do a session or whatever. Sometimes you have to record over another person's beat or whatever, but it will give you the opportunity to be in the studio all day, which is eventually what you want to do. The next thing is mixing. If you get good at mixing vocals and all that stuff, you can start to charge people for doing mixes. Because even me, I got so good at mixing that I even enjoyed doing mixes that weren't made on my productions. So then you can start charging for mixes, and the better you get, the more demand there will be and the more your price can go up and stuff like that. So if you just get good at a lot of things, you will have a lot more options, you know. And the last thing is kind of a special thing, it's kind of a little bit of an extra, but it's DJing. As soon as you've built up a brand as a producer, you can start, or even before that, you can just start to also learn how to DJ, because a lot of DJs eventually become producers and vice versa. In your free time, try to learn how to DJ, because DJing will give you the ability to get your music in front of an audience. I know now with COVID and shit, it's not happening, but they will give you the time to prepare for when the parties are back and all of that stuff. So learn how to DJ so you can get your music out there. Eventually, if you have a lot of placements, you can start to DJ the music that you've placed in your sets, which is really cool. So it all depends on what you want to do. So those were 11 ways to make money as a producer. It's not like these are the only ways to make money, or these you have to do all of these things to make money as a producer, but just there's so many options, and it all comes down to, if you get good at something and you have a lot of value, you will attract a lot of money. That's just basically how life works. Build up your value and you won't have to think about money. Like, the better you get at making beats, the better you get at recording, the better you get at mixing, the bigger your brand will be, the more brands will come towards you, the more streams you will have, the more artists you will place, the more, you know. So build up your value as a producer. That's basically it. That's the most important lesson I want to give you guys in this episode. Hey, I hope I enjoyed this episode, bro. It was good to be out of the FL Studio shit for once and just talk to you guys, because I feel like it's also really important in your musical career to sometimes step back and see and look at yourself and look at what you're doing and look at the kind of plan of what you're doing. So hey, that's basically it. Before we end the video, I just want to answer some of your questions. Hey bro, on God, I need your help. I don't find any tutorials for my problem. I got a MIDI keyboard with drum pads for Christmas, and I do not find any good tutorial on how to work with these drum pads in FL Studio. The thing is, FL Studio isn't the best piece of software to work with a lot of these hardware things. All of these hardware things will work well with Logic and Ableton or whatever. With FL Studio, you'll have to do some manual programming. There are a couple of ways to use the drum pads that you have in FL Studio, but you will need to use an instance of Fruity FPC and then empty it out and just look for a Fruity FPC tutorial, because that will, you will learn everything about using drum pads on the FPC there. Yo, where did you get the mouse pad with the shortcuts for FL Studio? This was actually this right here. It's really cool. It's got the shortcuts for FL Studio on the mouse pad. It was sent to me by Inside Audio in collaboration with Larry O on Instagram. His Instagram tag will be right here. So just go over to Larry O and check him out. You can get the pad right there. Not sponsored. Yo, is you Dutch or not? I'm Belgian, so I speak Dutch and French and English, and it's next to the Netherlands, so I'm not Dutch, but I speak Dutch, you know. Just one question: what the is sampler, and why is it always there, like without even without a sound? Sampler is like a little program that FL Studio uses to load up sounds into FL Studio. To drag in a sample, you have to have a sampler there for the program to be able to read your samples. Yo, Chuki, I think my beats are trash. What should I do? Make more beats, bro. Just make beats for a year and your beats won't be trash anymore. Hey, how can I be good at making chords? Because I'm not good at making chords because I ain't cool with any instruments, let alone the keyboard. I want to know how to. you could use chord packs, or you could also use in the FL Studio piano roll. You can go up to the top left corner and there's a menu there called helpers, and there you can highlight the scales. So if you just select the scale that your track is in, you can see which notes are actually in that scale and which notes aren't. So you can make your chords from there. And yeah, apart from that, if you really want to learn how to know the chords, you will have to study music theory and know the chords, bro. That's the reality of what it is, bro. So hey, today we learned how to make money as a producer. Within 1 year, I want to see y'all being rich or at least making some amount of money off of your producing, because it's really possible, you know, with the internet and everything like that. It is really possible. Just know that you have to really want it. It's not for everybody, but it's also not impossible to do it. So I'm just saying, good luck. If you want to do it, go get it. Go for your dreams. Do it. And if it doesn't work out, don't stress. Just keep going, keep going, keep going, and eventually you'll get there. Much love. Leave a like if you enjoyed the video. Subscribe if you haven't already. Follow my Instagram at Chuki with a Z, because somebody else knows my name. And if you really want to do me a favor, follow me on Spotify. Much love.
Bye. Bye.